God be with you. Welcome to our worship at Faith Lutheran Church in Kelowna, BC today. Today is the 10th Sunday after Pentecost. We continue reading in the Gospel of Matthew, which is the Gospel for year A. And we continue reading in the book of Genesis. Now we get a whole series of stories around the life of Joseph. We begin with the brief order for confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our first hymn, Dearest Jesus, at your word.
Jesus, at your word we have come again to hear you. Let our thoughts and hearts be stirred and in glowing faith be near you. As the promises here given draw us wholly up to our knowledge, sense, and sight lie in deepness darkest shrouded, till your Spirit breaks the night, filling us with light unclouded. All good thoughts and all good living come but by your gracious giving. Radiance of God's glory bright, light of light from God proceeding. Jesus, send your blessed light, help our hearing, speaking, heeding. Our songs and prayers may please you, as with grateful hearts we praise you. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, praise to you and adoration. Grant us what we need the most, all your gospel's consolation. While we here on earth await you, till in heaven with praise we greet you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, our defender, storms rage around and within us and cause us to be afraid. Rescue your people from despair. Deliver your sons and daughters from fear, and preserve us in the faith of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
First reading is from Genesis chapters 37, verses 1 to 4, and 12 to 28. Though Joseph was Jacob's favorite son, his jealous brothers sold him into slavery. Judah, who protected Joseph's life, later gives a moving speech before Joseph in Egypt, indicating that the brothers have changed their ways. Here begins the reading. Jacob settled in the land where his father had lived as an alien, the land of Canaan. This is the story of the family of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was shepherding the flock with his brothers. He was a helper to the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah, his father's wives, and Joseph brought a bad report of them to their father. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any other of his children, because he was the son of his old age, and he had made him a long robe with sleeves. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. Now his brothers went to pasture their father's flock at Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, "Are not your brothers pasturing the flock at Shechem? Come, I will send you to them." He answered, "Here I am." So he said to him, "Go now, see if it is well with your brothers and with the flock, and bring word back to me." So he sent him from the valley of Hebron. He came to Shechem and found a man wandering in the fields. The man asked him, "What are you seeking?" "I am seeking my brothers," he said. "Tell me, please, where they are pasturing the flock." The man said, "They have gone away, for I heard them say, 'Let us go to Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. They saw him from a distance, and before he came near to them, they conspired to kill him. They said to one another, "Here comes his dreamer. Come now, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we will say that a wild animal has devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams." But when Reuben heard it, he delivered him out of their hand, saying, "Let us not take his life." Reuben said to them, "Shed no blood. Throw him into this pit here in the wilderness, but lay no hand on him, that he might rescue him out of their hand and restore him to his father." So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the long robe with the sleeves that he wore, and they took him and threw him into a pit. The pit was empty. There was no water in it. Then they sat down to eat, and looking up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead with their camels carrying gum, balm, and resin on the way to carry it down to Egypt. Then Judah said to his brothers, "What profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him, for he is our brother, our own flesh." And his brothers agreed. When some Midianite traders passed by, they drew Joseph up, lifting him out of the pit, and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And they took Joseph to Egypt. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me!" Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We have a special treat today. Anna Hisdale has recorded a song for us, and so she will sing, and we will go to hear her now, "Morning Has Broken."
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning. Praise for them springing fresh from the word. Sweet the rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dewfall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where God's feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day.
Thank you, Anna. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. A 5-year-old girl was at the beach with her father, who had promised to teach her to swim that summer. It was a hot and sunny day, a perfect day for their first lesson. As she stood in the water above her waist, her father stood on the shore giving directions. He was telling her how she first needed to hold her breath so that she could keep the water out of her mouth. Then he explained how she needed to stiffen her body and lay flat in the water so that she could float. And finally, she needed to kick her legs and rotate her arms. If she could master all those things and do them all at once, then she would be swimming on her own in no time. The young girl looked quizzically at her father. She didn't quite understand. So the dad repeated himself, this time gesturing with his arms and legs and body. She still wasn't catching on. She tried holding her breath and putting her face in the water. She didn't like that. She tried lying flat in the water, but her fear of sinking meant that her feet never left the ground, so it wasn't much use. Both father and daughter were getting frustrated. The more the dad gave commands and flailed his arms and legs, the more upset the young girl became. She began to cry. Then it suddenly occurred to her father that if his daughter was ever to learn how to swim, he was going to have to get into the water with her and show her how it's done. Talking about it and shouting directions from a distance wasn't doing a thing. The only way that she was going to learn to swim was if her father got in the water with her so that she could hold on to him when she needed to, and he could catch her when she began to sink. So that's exactly what he did. Stepping into the lake and going over to where his daughter was, the first thing he did was hug her and assure her that he was there to help in whatever way she needed. Eventually, her tears stopped, and she was ready to try again. This time, when the dad told her to hold her breath, he took a deep breath himself, plugged his nose, and submerged his face. The little girl did the same. She came up sputtering, but she had done it. Dad cheered. Next, when she tried floating, her father put his hands on her stomach and her shoulders, lifting her off the ground and safely and firmly holding her at the surface. She could feel what it was like to float with her dad supporting her. And from that position, she began kicking her legs and swinging her arms as her dad moved her through the water. She wasn't really swimming, but she was getting the sensation of what it would be like when she finally did learn. With many more attempts like this, by the end of that summer, the young daughter was swimming in the shallows all by herself. And it was only possible because the father had got right into the water with his daughter and got close enough that she could feel him supporting her and guiding her as he was giving her instructions. In a sense, that father and daughter learning to swim is a good image of God and us. Many times, God is spoken of as a supreme being. As children, we think of God living up there, in the sky, in heaven, in a galaxy far, far away. We imagine God looking down upon us and watching us from a distance. Immortal, invisible, God only wise, declares a well-known hymn, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes. The ancient Greek philosopher Aristotle described God as the unmoved mover. In the 20th century, Paul Tillich called God the ground of being. The scriptures often use words like almighty and eternal and sovereign to describe God. These are all descriptions of God as transcendent, God above us and beyond us, God so totally different and other from us. God's ways are not our ways, says the prophet Isaiah, and our thoughts are not God's thoughts. Surely it is true that we are not God, nor can we ever hope to achieve such a level of consciousness or being. God is God, and we are not. God is transcendent, and we are not. We depend on God being all-wise and all-knowing, and that can be a source of great comfort and consolation to us. But God is not only transcendent, not only immortal, invisible, God only wise. In the person of Jesus of Nazareth, God has taken on flesh and blood and become one of us. God has drawn near to us and our human condition and has become immanent. While we rely on God being in and through and above all, and trust that the wisdom of God surpasses the wisdom of human beings, we also celebrate the fact that God does not remain that way, distant and aloof, withdrawn and unattached. We rejoice and we find great comfort in a God who comes near to us, who takes on our nature and our lot, who knows what it is like to be human, who knows what it is like to hurt and to suffer all the limitations and indignities of being human. One of the reasons Christ Jesus is such good news for us is because in him the fullness of God dwells. God, in all of God's transcendent glory, comes to live in the humble flesh and bones of a human being. The Creator becomes a creation. The transcendent God becomes the immanent God. And we are the great beneficiaries of this divine mystery. We read this morning from St. Matthew's Gospel a story that seems to defy all human logic. The disciples are in a boat on the Sea of Galilee without Jesus. Jesus has left them to go by himself to pray. When he returns to where he left the disciples in the boat, a storm has come up and strong winds have blown the boat away from the shore. The text does not say why he starts out across the water to join the disciples in the boat, only that the disciples see Jesus walking towards them on the sea. Were the disciples calling out for help? Was the boat in danger of being capsized? Did Jesus see that the disciples were floundering to control the boat? We're not told. The other thing that we're not told is that the winds ceased prior to Jesus stepping out on the water. In fact, we can pretty safely assume that the storm was still raging when he did, because it isn't until after Jesus reaches the boat and gets in that the text says the winds ceased. So the picture we are painted by the author of St. Matthew's Gospel is one where there is a violent storm in progress. The boat the disciples are in is getting further and further from land, and Jesus steps out onto the sea in the midst of waves high enough to push a boat full of men away from shore. No wonder the disciples became afraid when they saw Jesus and wondered whether they were seeing things. Seeing the disciples react this way, Jesus speaks to reassure them. "Take heart, it is I," he says. "Do not be afraid." What I find so incredible about this story is not so much that Jesus comes to them while they're out in the water on the sea, that Jesus walks on top of the water to go to where they are. I think the truly miraculous thing here is that Jesus sets out to come to them in the midst of a storm. Jesus does not stand on the shore and shout to them and wave his arms. He doesn't call on a rescue boat to go get them. Instead, he just walks straight into the thick of the storm to offer assistance to the disciples. They're in trouble, and he wants to help them. Storm or no storm, there is no waiting. He must go, and he must go now. That is the level of compassion he feels for his disciples. That is the depth of his love for them. We get so easily distracted by what we traditionally have called the miracle here, Jesus walking on water, that we can totally miss the miraculous love that Jesus shows for the disciples. That Jesus was willing to go without delay and without waiting for the storm to cease is the first and perhaps greatest miracle in this story. It is an image of and a reminder of the good news that God does not stay far, far away in a heaven somewhere, shouting commands and gesticulating wildly. God loves us so much that God takes all the risks associated with becoming human to come near to us and to save us. Like that father teaching his daughter how to swim, it's only once he is in the water beside her that the child can begin to understand and start doing it. We have a God who not only is transcendent, all-knowing, all-seeing, and all-wise, but who is also immanent. The God that Jesus came proclaiming, who raised him from the dead and promises to save us from ourselves, is a God who comes to us in the midst of the storms that batter us and pull us away from shore. This is the greatest mystery, that God is both transcendent and immanent, that God can be both beyond us and beside us at the same time. That is the depth of God's love for us, and there is no length to which God will not go to show it to us. Immanence means not only that God is with us, but that God is with us always, even in the midst of storms. That is the love that is life and light to us. That is the love that we carry to the rest of the world and which empowers our living and our serving. It is a love that risks, a love that is untiring in its concern for the welfare of all, a love that calms our fears and truly is miraculous. Amen. Go now by the power of the Holy Spirit to be the church in mission, to do the will of God in the world. Amen. We continue as we sing our hymn of the day, Eternal Father, Strong to Save. This is the old naval hymn. And I have a brother who worked for a while with the, played for the Naval Reserve Band, and he said they played this so often that they could probably all play it by heart. And so we sing Eternal Father, Strong to Save.
Its own appointed limits keep. We cry, O God of majesty, for those in peril on the sea. O Christ, whose voice the waters heard and hushed their raging at your walked upon the surging deep, and in the storm lay calm in sleep. We cry, O Lord of Galilee, for those in peril on the sea. Creator Spirit, were fashioned sea and sky and earth, who made the stormy chaos cease and gave us life and light and peace. We cry, O Spirit, strong and free, for those in peril sea. O Trinity of love and power, preserve their lives in danger's hour. From rock and tempest, flood and flame, protect them by your holy name. And to your glory let there be glad hymns of praise from land and sea.
Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith using these words from Bread for the World, an organization that advocates for food security domestically. I believe in God, maker of an unfinished world, who calls us to participate in bringing about the fullness of creation. God who created abundant resources to provide for all. God who has not divided people into rich and poor, owners and slaves, nor pitted us against each other because of race, color, social class, or sex. I believe in Jesus Christ, who was ridiculed, tortured, and executed for the sins of humankind. He has overthrown the rule of evil and injustice. He continues to judge and redeem the hatred and arrogance of human beings. I believe in the Spirit of God, whose flame comforts us with divine presence and causes our hearts to burn for righteousness and justice. I believe in the reconciling power of God in my life and in the world. I believe that God, through people, can bring peace and hope, justice and equality, the relief of suffering and pain, and the final triumph of love and grace. Amen.
Prayers of Intercession. Confident of your care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the Church, the world, and all who are in need, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For your whole church throughout the world, give courage in the midst of storms, so that we see and hear Jesus calling. Take heart. It is I. Do not be afraid. May we follow Christ wherever he leads. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the well-being of your creation, protect waterways, forests, lands, and wildlife from exploitation and abuse. Help the human family endeavor to sustain and be sustained by the resources of your hand. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the nations and their leaders, in you steadfast love and faithfulness meet, and righteousness and peace kiss. May nations in conflict know the peace that is the fruit of justice, and the justice that is the path to peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those in need, everyone who calls upon your name will be saved. Accompany all who are lonely. Hear the voices of those who cry out in anguish, and support those who are frustrated in their search for an affordable place to live. We pray for those suffering this day, especially those we name aloud or silently in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For our congregation, you have gathered us as your people, and we thank you for the gift of community. We pray for students and teachers preparing for a new school year, and for those struggling with unexpected hardship. Supply us generously with your grace for our life together. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks, O God, for the saints of the whole church from all times and places, and for the saints in our lives and in our community whom you have gathered to yourself. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In a certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. Our final hymn for today, My Life Flows On in Endless Song.
Flows on in endless song, above earth's lamentation. I catch the sweet though far off hymn that hails a new creation. No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since Christ is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing? Through all the tumult and the strife, I hear that music ringing. It finds an echo in my soul. How can I keep from singing? No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since Christ is Lord of heaven and earth, can I keep from singing? What though my joys and comforts die, the Lord my Savior liveth. What though the darkness gather round, songs in the night he giveth. No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since Christ is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing? The peace that Christ makes fresh my heart, a fountain ever springing. All things are mine since I am his. How can I keep from singing? No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. If Christ is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing?
Go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.